But anyway, we're here. Hey, we never said we were expert at this. We just said that we would come on and talk to everybody. Yeah. So, yeah, so this is what, Johnny? This is our end of the year kind of live stream, I guess?
Yes.
Yeah, this is our end of the year live stream. Happy holidays, everybody, by the way.
Yeah, happy Hanukkah, happy Christmas.
Happy Christmas, Merry Christmas, happy Hanukkah, or whatever you celebrate this time of year. It's just always good to be around friends and family.
I do both. We celebrate both here. So
more gifts for the kids.
Double bubble.
Yep. My daughter's upstairs wrapping gifts as we speak for the first time. She's cutting her wrapping paper and, you know, rolling it up in a ball and throwing a bunch of tape on it. So she's all excited. So that's fun. Well,
she is A, better at wrapping than me, and B, she's more efficient because she's doing it. And I still have
mine to do. Yeah, well, she wanted to do it. This is the first time. She says, I want to do it all by myself, Daddy. I said, okay. You know, she's 7.
Good for her.
So I said, good for you. Wrap our gifts. So that's what she's doing.
And how old did you say she was, mate?
She's 7. She's 7, 7 and a half. Yeah. So,
yeah, almost the same age as my daughter.
Yeah. So you know what it's all about. So it's all about them, and we're having fun, and we're baking cookies and all that stuff, and it's a good time. So, yeah. So Johnny and I thought we would get on and just, you know, talk to everyone, say, hey, what's going on? Merry Christmas to all our followers. It's usually a lot of the same names we see all the time. You guys are great. All the same names show up. And so I hope all of you have a great holiday season. And we kick off 2018 with some great stuff and training and mixing and plugins and recording and blah, 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 blah. So Johnny, did you buy yourself any home studio gear, anything for Christmas, anything for the holidays, any plugins, any new stuff? What's new in your studio outside of the fact that I see you've cleaned it up and you've taken out that big piece of furniture in the back corner and you had a studio overhaul?
Oh, I did. Yes, I had a major overhaul. We basically packed down the studio, moved it out into the lobby, and built a new desk. So right in front of me right now is a brand new desk from IKEA, from IKEA of all places. And I have a Studio Live 16 Series 3.
Yes.
Which is sat in front of me now. It was kind of over here because there was nowhere really to put it on my old desk.
Yep.
But in order to do that, we had to make room because this desk is just a little bit bigger than the old one.
Right.
So the beautiful chest of drawers that was in the corner, that was full of loads of stuff, took me 2 full days to empty that drawer unit.
Wow.
yeah, it was totally full of completely relevant stuff, which is rare. Yeah. So that's gone now. And we sold it for about £300.
No kidding.
Lovely. Yeah, we're gonna put it on. I was just like, I've had this for years. You know, just whack it on eBay for like £50.
Yeah, someone can just come take it, right?
Yeah, basically. Until I realized exactly what it was that we had. One of the bidders actually sent me an email saying, "Are you aware of what that is?" And I said, "No." So he basically gave me some details.
Oh, that was nice. He said,
"Go look it up." So I went and looked it up and realized that it's actually worth a fortune.
Wow, good for you. So now what do you have in the corner there in its place? You have a television, I see. And then what do you have underneath there? It looks like some old some stereo equipment. Am I right?
Yes. Yeah, I've got an old cassette player.
Nice.
A power amp. That's an old solid-state power amp.
Yep.
We got a VCR player because I still have a whole ton of VCRs.
VHS tapes, yeah.
That's the one. Yep. Yeah, I you know me, letters. Yep. And it's sitting on a table that actually survived World War II. Belonged to my grandmother.
Oh, nice.
Her house didn't survive World War II, but that table did.
Well, there you go.
So he's kind of in here for good luck. And there's my fretless bass.
Nice. Yep, I see it.
So that chest of drawers is gone, which is actually, this is an interesting point to make, actually. It's totally changed the acoustics of this room.
Well, really?
Yeah.
Okay. Really?
I didn't realize that drawer unit was effectively acting as a massive bass trap. And it was just absorbing lots of low end in this room. So now that we've taken that out, suddenly there's like a ton of bass in the room.
Wow. So now you need some bass trapping in the corner at one point?
So I need to get some more bass trapping. Yeah. So, I mean, I've got some behind that you can't see, but... Right. I'm definitely going to have to put something in that corner. like, I don't know, I'm going to have to get something from GIK, I think, because they make really big, thick, robust bass traps.
Yeah, they do.
So, yeah, I'm going to have to go and do that. And, yeah, my saxophone and my guitar, they are in the lounge at the moment. And I was going to try and get my Fender Rhodes in here and have that on this side of the studio, but doesn't quite fit.
Yeah, oh yeah, I wouldn't think it would.
No, I would have loved, because I've got this, and I use the Fender Rhodes sound on this quite a lot, and occasionally I mic up the one that's in the lounge, but I just thought, wouldn't it be nice if I could just actually have my actual Fender Rhodes in here? But it doesn't fit, so it's going to stay in the lounge. Sorry, folks, for those of you that wanted to see it.
So yeah, a big studio overhaul. That's really cool. Any new any other recording gear? Any new plugins? Anything recently since last time we talked?
Are you all just... Have I got any new plugins? No. I resisted all the sales and stuff.
Yeah, a lot of sales, man. Still a lot of sales going on.
Still, yeah. I see that SSL bus compressor. Is that still on sale at $29?
It was. That's the for people in the chat. That's the Waves. SSL yep. Bus compressor. So that's usually part of the SSL bundle, which comes with the channel strip and the EQ and something else. Two EQs, I think. Oh, no, it comes EQ. With two channel strips and EQ and then the bus compressor. Well, they took the bus compressor out of the bundle and they're selling it as for $29. And I have it. Yeah. It's nice. So if you guys get a chance to get that, if you want an SSL bus compressor, that's the one. That's a nice one to have.
Yeah, sure. I just started using the Slate FGX, I think it is. Yep. I was not on a mix today actually, and it sounds absolutely gorgeous.
Yeah, that's the compressor limiter. The master. Yeah. I use that all the time. That's the limiter that I use on everything.
Oh, it sounds lovely.
Yeah,
it really does.
It does. It sounds great.
Careful not to overcook it. I learned very quickly. You don't want to push too much into it. That's what I found out. But
yeah, I just kind of hit the needle just so it just kind of dances a little bit, and then
yeah.
And what I love about that plugin is that you have the where you could crank up the limiter, and then you have that button that turns, you know, that but I forget what they call it, it's a monitor button.
Oh yeah.
So you can you can push that in and crank up the gain. You don't get blasted in the face. You just got to be careful, and then you could take the button off, and you can see how much gain you've added to your signal, which is really nice. And I think the metering is pretty accurate on that too.
Yeah, it looks. I did do some testing on that actually to see this. To see how it runs up against, the Studio One, peak meter,
yeah,
and in both RMS and K14 K20 modes as well, and yeah, it's pretty much dead on.
Yeah, so that's a really nice plugin. I use that all the time. The only plugin that I bought was the we looked at it last couple of weeks ago, the Tony Maserati Signature Series stuff. Which I really like, and I did a you guys haven't seen them yet. I've done a bunch of YouTube videos, in-depth reviews on each one of those plugins, and they're all scheduled to come out over the next 4 or 5 weeks. I've already got them uploaded on YouTube. They're going to be releasing every week, so those are done. And I bought the Waves Abbey Road Reverb, which I really like.
Ooh,
That was like $29.
That's got a whole bunch of plates and stuff, isn't it?
It does. Yeah, I could show it to you guys later. After. Yeah, it does. It's really nice. And that was $29. I bought that. And I think that was it. There was... I think that was... That's all I really got during the sales this year, which was just those two things. I don't think I picked anything else up offhand. No. That was really it. So I'm using those plugins now, and they're good. I like them. I like them a lot. So,
that's cool. Greg is saying to turn up your mic 3 dB.
Me? Sure.
Yeah.
Okay, let me turn down my headphones a little because I've already got a headache today. Okay, so there we go. How's that?
That's cooking in my ears.
Is it?
hopefully that's better for folks. Alexander says, Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
That's hilarious. I like that. It's a typo, but it's a fun one.
James says he's thinking of getting the PreSonus Central Station Plus, the Central Station Plus. Does anyone have one? I've never used one, but I heard they're really good units. I've never used one, though. I'm sure they're good.
The Central Station Plus is fantastic. You really do get a beautiful sound out of it, and it's kind of like the Monitor Station version 2, but you've got a whole bunch more monitoring options that are really, really selectable, and you've got the remote that comes with that as well.
Cool.
So,
yeah, Malcolm says the Abbey Road Plate Reverb is super nice, but a little hard on the CPU, and Greg Lewis says it's a CPU hog. Yeah, I don't have that issue because of the computer that I have. So, and again, I'm only using like maybe 3 or 4 instances of it in a mix, so it's not killing my computer. And as a matter of fact, I did a it'll come out in January. It's already filmed. A 3-part studio tour video series. And part one, I show all of my computers up close, all the hard drives, the specs of the computer, the universal audio satellite systems. And we talk a lot about that stuff because people ask about that. So when you see that video, you'll see why I really don't have. I'm fortunate that CPU and DSP and all that stuff is not an issue for me at all. I could put anything in my mix, and I can put many, many instances of them, and I never have any problems.
Well, your computer could pretty much run the mission to Mars and back, probably.
I guess, yeah. It is overkill. But I did that because I looked at it as an investment. And I knew I was going to have it for 10 years. And I said, and if that's the case, I want to overbuy. And I really overbought it more for the video side of it than the audio side because of all the video editing I do in Final Cut Pro. And that's really where, you need a real fast processor and you need lots of RAM. And when you, so I really spec'd it out as a high performance, at least at that time, a high performance video workstation. And then for audio, it's a breeze, you know, so. So I don't need to worry about that, which is great. But that's really cool. Let's see. We'll scroll back up here. Okay, James says, wonder if I need with the Studio Live 3. He must be answering something.
Andy says that's related to his Presonus Central Station.
Oh.
Yeah.
Okay. Andy says, my new board should be here soon, waiting on the 13th. Yeah, Andy... I saw some of your Facebook. You have 2 Series 3 mixers. Is that what the deal is with you? You got 2 of them?
I think he's getting the 32 with the 32R, which is the stage box.
Oh, okay. Oh, right, because Andy does a lot of live sound. So that would make sense.
I think that's right, Andy.
Yeah, Truckster says he got a new acoustic guitar for Christmas and it's great. Oh, great. What kind of acoustic?
I'd like to know the answer to that as well, actually, because my dad is an acoustic guitar expert.
Yeah, you were telling me that. I haven't opened up my acoustic guitar case in a while, other than to just humidify it in a while.
There you go. Andy says he'll be getting the 16 with the 32R.
Nice.
There you go. That's going to give you a ton of inputs and stuff.
James says he's trying out the Neutron 2. Who's that? Is that Isotope?
It is Isotope.
Seems okay. I've never really used any Isotope stuff, but I know it's good stuff. I mean, a lot of people that use it really say good things about it. I just don't know much about their stuff.
Yeah, they kind of do like a ton of stuff under the hood that you, from the GUI point of view, don't tend to really get to see. So, yeah, for me anyway, some of it appears to be kind of like trial by ears.
Yeah.
The GUI is usually pretty. You know, clear cut, simple, not a lot there.
Yeah. Greg says, how much RAM do you use, David? 64 gigs.
God, good grief.
And it could go up to 100. I think I can do up to 128. I think I could go higher than that in this particular machine, but 64 is all I need.
128 and you'd be running the FBI and NASA.
That's right. Andy, hey David, yeah. I need to know a great stage mic stand that has lots of pro live sound. Wait, hold on a second. Let me scroll back up. I need to know a great stage mic stand. I do lots of pulls and cheap. You want to know what kind of mic stands you need, Andy? Go look at my video on my website, Triad Orbit. Now they're expensive. Yeah. I'm not going to lie to you, but let me tell you what. You'll never buy another mic stand again. these things are like, you know, these things you can, I mean, hell, and they're great protection too. You could probably kill someone if you hit someone over the head with it. I mean, these things, these things are massive. And they don't knock over on stage. What I really like about them too, if you check my YouTube channel and you check them out, Andy, the legs, the footprint can be very, very small. So like on a drum kit, you can get a lot of stands around that kit in a very small footprint of the way the design is. And they also have all kinds of different quick, they have like a quick release coupler kind of a system where you can put all kinds of attachments. So you can put like one stand with a special boom arm with three microphones for toms. I mean, it's really cool. And again, they're heavy, heavy, heavy duty. They're not the $29 mic stands that you buy in Guitar Center or anything like that. So it's Triad Orbit's the name. I have them all in my studio and they're fantastic. You'll never buy another mic stand again.
Yeah, who needs guns when you've got a set of Triad Orbits?
Yeah, you don't need a gun. You could kill someone with these. I mean, these things are heavy, man. They're awesome. They're really, really built well. Let's see. Wino EQ is fantastic. I don't know what that means. He must be responding.
Yeah, there's Puya. A bit of a discussion going on.
Okay,
about
okay. I won't interrupt your guys. It's good. James says he likes the Kelmhelm stuff. Yeah, we looked at that months ago, yeah, right, John?
Yeah, we did the MUJC compressor.
Yeah, that was it.
It's like three compressors in one, which I've not used for a little while because I kind of only use it on certain styles of music. Like I'll use it on folk stuff or real acoustic stuff quite a lot, but I don't really tend to use it for jazz stuff or my own stuff really. But yeah, it sounds all three models are great. I have no idea what compressors he's modeled them after. I need to ask him actually.
They sound really good though, because I remember liking them, and they're really cheap. One was free and one was real cheap, right?
25 euros,
mm-hmm.
Which is actually these days that's like £20.
Yeah. Alexander said he got Superior Drummer 3 for Christmas. Oh, cool. That's really cool. I heard that just came out. Superior Drummer is a great program.
Yes.
Truckster says, Dave, did that song I send you usable? Oh, yeah. Hey, Truckster from Learning to Mix. Yeah, I think, yeah, it was. As a matter of fact, I think there were so many people, thankfully, a lot of new members now are sending in their songs to be mixed. So I think I have 6 or 8 of them. Yours is one of them. And a bunch of people sent me just the MP3s, and I said, send me the STEM files. I don't know if you did that, Truckster. Let me know if you did that. But I remember listening to the rough that you sent me. Oh, yeah, definitely. I think it's usable. And we're going to do it. I just don't know what month yet. I have to talk to Pete about it. But thank you. That's going to be fun to mix your guys' music.
Yeah, I'm so glad that a whole bunch more people have done that, because it means you guys don't have to use another one of my songs again.
No, we're going to use one of your songs, I'm sure. Yeah, we have now probably, if we used everything that was submitted to us, we probably have most of 2018 covered, if we wanted to.
Maybe January 2019.
Yeah, some of the problem is, though, a lot of the music, it's all great, but a lot of it's in the same kind of genre. So we're trying to pick, you know, like this month, well, you guys don't know about it yet, but in January, we're doing a hip-hop rap song. And if you didn't see my latest YouTube video that just went up yesterday,
yep,
a lot of you here probably have seen it, where I took a section of the bass that I was working on a bass, and we were doing, I was comparing it to a reference track. Because the reason why we're doing a hip-hop song, well, Pete's really familiar with hip-hop music. I am completely not familiar with hip-hop music in the way, from a mix perspective, it should sound. Yep. So I thought it was a great idea. And I said, and in my intro and in the rap, if you guys are part of Learning to Mix, you'll see this in January, where I talk about, well, what happens if you get a track or you have a potential job or a client or someone who wants to pay you money or whatever to mix a genre of music that you're not familiar with and that you're not comfortable with, or even music that you might not like?
I'm in that boat right now.
Yeah, you were telling me you're doing a house record or something, right?
Yeah, I'm doing a house record. I'm playing on it and I'm mixing and mastering it as well.
See, that's really cool. And so it really pushes you out of your comfort zone. And so because I haven't mixed a rap record in probably, God, it's got to be 10 years, I said we're going to learn together. So in going through all of that, we were on bass. And the bass, I don't know if it was a bass played or if it was a bass sample, but the low end was, I mean, the frequencies were low. I mean, low, low, low. I mean, it was like rumble in the room low, right? Really cool. And I said, well, we took a couple of reference tracks because I don't familiar with the style of music. So I said, well, this is how we're going to mix to the reference track. And in all that, I realized that their bass in the reference track wasn't nearly as low as mine. And then I started working with filters and stuff. And anyway, it was really cool. It's about a 13-minute demonstration. And we did it to, you know, I did it in real time so people could see it. And then when I was done with that particular part of the video, I said, geez, I should cut that up and put it on YouTube because that would be a really cool thing to show. And that's what I did.
Was really cool about that was how high you high passed in the end.
Yes.
Without losing the substance and the weight of the bass.
Yes. I think I settled on 240 or 50 hertz. And honestly, if I go back and listen again, I could probably roll it up a little higher. It started to sound more like the reference track. And so it was pretty cool. Yeah, I thought it was an interesting example. And so it's really cool that we're doing a different style. We haven't done R&B or hip hop yet. And so with all the submissions that we're getting, a lot of them are a lot more mainstream sounding. And so we don't want to do five or six of those in a row. We're trying to mix it up, you know, because I think that's important. I think it's important that we do many styles of music. We have a real hard rock track that's ready to go, but that one was like 120. It was like 120 tracks. And I said, I don't know if we could do that, especially in the month of December with Christmas. I don't know how we can get I could get that ready for January. But we have a hard rock track. We have some acoustic stuff. You know, we have so I'm really glad everybody's sending their stuff, and we will get to all of it. I promise you. We will get to all of it. I just don't know what month yet. So yeah, so the January mix will be interesting if you're not used to hip hop and rap. If you're not used to, and it's not like hardcore like rap. It's got a rap male vocal, but then there's a lot of female vocals on the choruses and on the doubles and stuff, and it's all very melodic. It's you know, it's like singing with melody and stuff, so it's kind of, you know, blending those two kinds of vocal styles together. It is pretty cool. It's not like real hardcore, you know, with foul language. It's not like that. It's a lot more musical than that. You know what I mean? So, so that was interesting, I thought.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to getting into that, actually.
Yeah, it's fun. I have one more video of that to record, and then I'll be done with it. And it's been a learning experience for me.
I was gonna ask, actually, if you kind of have a recommended list of reference tracks that you've kind of gleaned through doing the mix already.
I have two that I used that were recommendations from Pete, because I didn't have no clue. I said, Pete, you got to help me with this. He said, listen to these two songs. They're very similar. And I did. And I'll provide them as part of the I bought them on iTunes. I paid $1 or whatever. And I'll put the MP3 in the folder so people can use those if they would like. So you can use the same reference track. Yeah, that's totally fine.